Okay, so we're recording. All right. There was a doctor, Timothy McGrew, and he was on the radio, and he went through a teaching called Alive. You know, why do Christians believe that Jesus is alive? And I thought it was epic. Now, they gave the PowerPoint presentation for free. And by the way, if you guys go to shotgunnow.net and click downloads, I'm going to put this in the download section. It's a very small file. It's not there yet, but by the time you watch this video on YouTube, it'll be there. There's 33 pages. I'm on page 2, so let's get going. Okay? So we're going to start off with 1 Corinthians 15:14. You can see that there, but that's not really what I wanted to read to you. Let's go. So we're going to be talking about why do we believe that Jesus Christ is alive? And the key word here is alive. And this will be a great tool that you can use to witness to your unsaved friends, of whom we love. The resurrection is a historical claim. It is subject to investigation as an event in history. So to argue for a historical claim, we need to do two things. We need to identify the relevant facts, and we need to evaluate competing explanations of those facts. So let's go through some background. Jesus died by crucifixion outside the walls of Jerusalem by the Roman authorities. E.P. Sanders lists this as one of the almost indisputable facts about Jesus' life in his book, Jesus and Judaism. After his death, here's another fact, he was buried in a nearby tomb. Jewish law required burial even for foreigners and for executed transgressors. And you could read about that in extra-biblical writings like Josephus. What happened next after Jesus died and was buried? Four explanations. His immediate followers did not claim he rose again. The Gospels are later myths. So some people say, well, they're just mythic theory. His followers were deceived into thinking that he rose again. That's another theory. That's called the hallucination theory or the twin theory. Do you know that, I know it sounds ridiculous, but some people claim, well, Jesus had a twin. Maybe that was it, you know, a twin brother. The third one is his followers deceived others into thinking that he rose again. That's known as the conspiracy theory. And then he rose again, which is what I believe based on the facts that you're going to see here, Christianity. This is the page. I was really excited that you guys see this. If you could remember Alive as we go through this, and I'm going to be asking you guys, just I'll ask the whole room, okay, what does I stand for? And see if you can memorize it. It took me a couple of times, and I memorized what ALIVE stands for. A is for the appearances of Jesus Christ. L is for the low status of women in that culture. We're going to tell you why that's important. That adds more weight to the evidence that Jesus is alive. I is for the immediate proclamation that Jesus is alive after his crucifixion. And V was the voluntary sufferings that his followers went through. And then E, the empty tomb. Jesus' tomb was found empty. So you got that, guys? Alive. Appearances, low status, immediate, voluntary, empty. Okay? Alive. All right, let's see if we can memorize it. Fact number one, appearances of Jesus. It cannot be denied that people claim to see appearances of Jesus. So the primary evidence that Jesus rose from the dead is that numerous people claim to have seen him alive after his death. Our sources for this include three of the Gospels, Matthew, Luke, John, Acts 1, 1 Corinthians 15, as well as numerous sermons in Acts. And when you go to shotgunnow.net, click downloads, I'll have this there and you could take notes on that. some conditions for unreliable eyewitness testimony. This is interesting. The events happened quickly over a period of seconds or minutes. The participants are strangers to one another. There is a weapon present, such as a knife or a gun. Now look what it says below. Under these conditions, eyewitness testimony is typically unreliable, particularly on details. Let's go to the next one. So what was the nature of the claimed appearances? They are public. Jesus appears to multiple people at once, Matthew 28, Luke 24, John 20 and 21, Acts 1, 1 Corinthians 15, 6. They are polymodal. They involve not just sight, but also hearing and conversation, touch, etc. They also are extended across time. This is not just one brief and confusing episode. Let's look at the date of the claims. If the Gospels and Acts are substantially historical, then claims of eyewitness encounters with the risen Jesus were the ground of Christian belief from the outset. The early creed in 1 Corinthians 15, 3-7 is independent evidence for the early claim to eyewitness encounters with Jesus. 1 Corinthians 15, 3-7. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received. This is what Paul is saying. Notice he's saying what I also received. And they scholars believe he received this right after his conversion to follow Jesus Christ. What is this that he is delivering? What did he receive? Here it is, the creed. That Christ died for our sins in accordance with Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Marks of early date. Pneumatic structure. This is a brief creed, about 50 words in Greek, designed for memorization. That's the creed we were just talking about. Use of Cephas. This is a name for Peter that was used little later on. And delivery to Paul. Paul received this creed either in Damascus or in Jerusalem shortly after his conversion, and we talked about that on the previous page. We're doing great, guys. We're almost there. Now, let's look at the explanations and see which one makes more sense. Well, it's obviously not mythic theory. It's not hallucination theory. It's not conspiracy theory. The more rational, logical choice is Christianity. Okay, so hey, guys, what did the A stand for again? Appearance. Thanks, Trevor. Thanks, Princess. What is L? Remember, we're spelling alive, so we're on L now. L stands for the low status of women in that culture. In the patriarchal society of Second Temple Judaism, women were not regarded highly. Prayer for an unborn child. Oh, by the way, this is interesting. These are actual prayers that they would say, look, oh God, let not my offspring be a girl, for very wretched is the life of women. Morning prayer, the men bless God who has not made me a Gentile, a slave, a woman. So what does this have to do, the low status of women, what's this have to do with adding more evidence that Jesus rose from the dead? Well, we'll show you. Watch. Look at this. Let no one talk with a woman in the street, no, not with his own wife. Let the words of the law be burned, says Rabbi Elazar, rather than committed to women. So why would the disciples say that women were the first at the tomb, and the male disciples were afraid. Why would they use the low status of women, which would actually hurt the credibility of if they were trying to trick people? The fact that the women are the first at the tomb can best be explained that they really were the first at the tomb, and the disciples recorded what to them was a most embarrassing moment in history, but they faithfully recorded it that they were afraid and it was the women that were there. See, if we were going to make up a story, we wouldn't use women in that culture. We would use men or Peter or some of the disciples that were at the tomb. Look at the testimony of women in Jewish law. These are extra-biblical sources that you can look up. Look what Josephus says in his Antiquities 4:8-15. But let not the testimony of women be admitted on account of the levity and boldness of their sex. Any evidence which a woman gives is not valid to offer. And then wherever the Torah accepts the testimony of one witness, it follows the majority of persons, so that two women against one man is identical with two men against one man. So why, if you're going to make up a story, you certainly don't want to say women went to the tomb. You certainly wouldn't do that. Any fictional embellished story would certainly have men, the male disciples, there. So the when you see that there's embarrassment involved, that's another good piece of proof and evidence that that is true. So speaking of embarrassment, this is what we're talking about. An embarrassing point. In all four Gospels, the first people at the empty tomb are women. As historians, we are obliged to comment that if these stories had been made up 5 years later, let alone 30, 40, or 50 years later, they would never have had Mary Magdalene in this role. To put Mary there is, from the point of view of Christian apologists wanting to explain to a skeptical audience that Jesus really did rise from the dead, it's like shooting themselves in the foot. But to us as historians, this kind of thing is gold dust. The early Christians would never, never have made this up. N.T. Wright, in his book, There Is a God. Okay, so we got, that's what L stands for. So what was the L standing for, guys? The low status of women in that culture. Yeah, so we got that. So let's see what I stands for. And we're halfway done. Thanks, guys, for going through this with me. And again, if you guys want this PowerPoint presentation, it'll be at shotgunnow.net in the download section. And if you have a PowerPoint viewer, which is free anywhere, you can view these. Let's go to I. And I think this is great. So when people say, well, why are you a Christian? Why aren't you Hindu? Or why aren't you this? Or why aren't you that? You could show them this and show them the abundance of proof and evidence. Fact three, the immediate, that's what the I stands for, immediate proclamation in Jerusalem. Immediately it happened. Every piece of first century evidence indicates that the resurrection was proclaimed in Jerusalem beginning at Pentecost just 50 days after Jesus' crucifixion at Passover. Hey, Knight, I'm doing a little recording here, man. We got a new PowerPoint presentation. Knight's always talking about this, too, so he'll like it. It's 33 pages long. I'm going to be on page 19. So, yeah, it's really good. I heard about it on Apologetics 315, and I heard the guy on the radio, and he said, yeah, I got a free PowerPoint presentation. I go, oh, I got to get it. The disciples stayed at Jerusalem even when the church came under heavy persecution. So it's called Alive Night. It's called Alive, and it's like acrostic for to remember how to explain the gospel to folks. So it's very helpful for me. And let's mosey along here. The apostles proclaimed the resurrection at Pentecost when Jerusalem expected the spread of the report and endeavored to prevent it. While the eyes of their enemies were yet sparkling with rage and madness, while cavalry was yet dyed with the blood they had spilt there, do impostors take such measures? would not they have waited till the fury of the Jews had been appeased, till judges and public officers had been changed, and till people had been less attentive to their dispositions? It makes sense that if they were imposters, they wouldn't have done that. But the apostles proclaimed the resurrection right at Pentecost, when it was at the height of height of controversy. The importance of place. In some places, at sometimes the report of a miracle might be allowed to pass without examination, particularly if it was very distant from the place where it is proclaimed. But in the case of the resurrection, proclaimed boldly upon the spot in Jerusalem, the enemies of Christianity had means, motive, and opportunity to discredit the account if they could. All right, we're on page 21 of 33. What were the results of that proclamation? This is astounding. Barely 7 weeks after Jesus' crucifixion, his followers are in the streets at a major Jewish festival proclaiming his resurrection, and thousands of people, almost certainly all devout Jews, are converted. Can you see why I left atheism, folks? This is proof and evidence. Atheism provided no proof and evidence. This is proof and evidence, though, here. The proof and evidence is clearly on the side of Christian theism. J.P. Moreland said something very big was going on. Let's go to page... Okay, so that's alive. So what does ALI stand for, guys? A was the appearances. L was the low status of women in that culture. And I was the immediate proclamation that Jesus is risen. All right, so now we got two more. Who wants to guess what V stands for? Let's go to the next page. Voluntary sufferings of the first witnesses to the resurrection. Voluntary suffering. Many people professing to be original witnesses of the risen Jesus voluntarily passed their lives in labors, dangers, and sufferings on account of their belief. These consequences were easy to foresee, as they could not reasonably hope for a favorable reception from the majority, either of Jews or of Gentile. The significance of voluntary suffering. People will sometimes brave persecution and risk death for something false, but they do not generally do so for something they know to be false. That's true. People will sometimes brave persecution and risk death for something false. That's true. But they do not generally do so for something they know to be false, unless they think they have a reasonable chance at some earthly reward that makes it worth the risk. This is the best recipe for starting a false religion. Offer them something tangible here and now. Worldly, tangible. Christianity promoted personal morality and temperance and minimized the importance of earthly power and wealth. The earliest preachers of the gospel lived by these principles, unlike some televangelists today. 1 Corinthians 9:6 and 2 Thessalonians 3:8. I found this pretty fascinating, the meaning of martyr. Martyrs are witnesses. No other religion was ever propagated by witnesses who had seen and heard and been every way conversant in what they witnessed concerning the principles of their religion. No religion, besides, was ever preached by men whose unalterable constancy under all kinds of sufferings at last died for asserting it, when they must of necessity have known whether it were true or false, and therefore certainly knew it to be true, or else they would never have suffered and died in that manner for it. And that was Robert Jenkin in his book, Evidence and Certainty of the Christian Religion. new rules of conduct. What did they abandon, these new followers of Jesus Christ? The animal sacrifice system, the binding authority of the law of Moses, belief in a conquering Messiah. What they adopted: Sunday, a work day, as a new day of worship, baptism as a new sign of a new covenant, communion as an act of remembrance of Christ's death. The same point stated by a modern authority. And you guys know this was a quote that I was looking for, and I've quoted it before, and it's really epic. Antonin Scalia, he's on the Supreme Court of the United States, he said, "It is not irrational to accept the testimony of eyewitnesses who had nothing to gain. The worldly wise do not believe in the resurrection of the dead. So everything from Easter morning to the ascension had to be made up by the groveling enthusiast as part of their plan to get themselves martyred." I mean, when you really think about it, are we to believe that the disciples all got together and concocted the story all for the sole purpose of being martyred? This is kind of the point that he's making here. All right, we're on page 28 of 33. So V was for what, guys? We got A was appearances, L was the low status of women of that culture, I was for the immediate proclamation of Jesus Christ, and V was for the voluntary suffering that the disciples took on. So what is E? Empty. The empty tomb. Fact number five. Most scholars, not just conservative Christian scholars, most scholars accept that the tomb was found empty on Sunday morning. This is partly because the story of the empty tomb is early and multiply attested. It is also partly because of the criterion of embarrassment. We mentioned that earlier. That was the L in alive, the low status of women in that culture. It is also partly because of the criterion of embarrassment and the fact that the tomb was discovered by women. The official story. Matthew gives us an account of the decision by the Jewish leaders to spin the story by saying that the disciples stole the body. Why would the Jewish leaders say the disciples stole the body? They're trying to cover up the empty tomb. They needed a cover story. The fact that the Jewish leaders were talking about the disciples stealing the body, using that as a made-up excuse to explain away the empty tomb, that adds more evidence that the tomb's obviously empty. In the middle of the second century, Justin Martyr, in his dialogue with Trypho, points out that the Jews are still sending people from city to city spreading that story. Nightmare is saying, some writers may toy with the fancy of a Christ myth, but they do not do so on the ground of historical evidence. And everyone's typing so fast it's scrolled up. this is a tacit confession that the Jews could not find the body. The Nazareth inscription, an imperial proclamation against grave robbing dated AD 41 and prescribing the death penalty for those who rob graves. This inscription dovetails with Claudius' trouble with the Jews in Rome, as described by Suetonius. So there you have it, folks. I hope you enjoy the presentation. Jesus is alive. And you can use this acrostic alive. So let's go through what we've learned. A is for the appearances. L is for the low status of women in that culture. I is for the immediate proclamation that Jesus rose again. V is for the voluntary deaths that the disciples took on and the suffering. And E is for the empty tomb. There's one more page, and we'll end it here. So God bless you guys. Thanks for watching. I really appreciate you guys going through this with me. If you want this PowerPoint presentation. I'm going to put it at shotgunnow.net. I'll put it in the download section, and you can download it. Also, if you go to, I think, apologetics315.com, and you can listen to this. They talked about this on the radio there. I listened to the MP3 today. It's the one titled Jesus is Alive, and that's where I found out about this. So thanks, guys, for listening, and have a great week.